No.
Welcome, glad you're here today. Some of the last warmish days I think we might see for quite a while in the next couple weeks here, it looks like. And today is Rally Sunday. I thank you for those of you that will join us online, and just want to let you know that next Sunday we will offer Sunday school at 9 a.m. in the hall. And very excited to begin some normalcy, hopefully, in this year as we move forward. And confirmation is also going to be starting this week. And I don't know why we're getting these pops once in a while. I don't know. I think it's just like, hopefully the battery isn't going to die. You thought we were pretty good, I think. So anyway, next Sunday we'll have a special gift for you when you come for Sunday school in the worship. And that'll be 9 to 9:30, and then worship will be at 9:30. And we also are going to bless the animals next Sunday, so bring your furry friends out to join you for worship, and we'll do that immediately after service. And we're going to begin with coffee after worship on October 4th in the hall with some social distancing. And we will also have a youth group tomorrow night for interested high schoolers and a little bit older age kids. And that'll be 6 to 7:30 in the church here. And I will be here on Tuesday this week, probably around 5 o'clock for some office hours. Is there any other announcements this morning that we need to do for the good of the group? Sure. Jody's got one.
The meatball supper. We decided to have a meatball supper, and you probably all kind of know that here. October 10th, and we're going to be serving curbside to go, and it'll be from 3 to 6, and we'll be either calling or bringing sign-up sheets for what you want to do, whether it's to donate or but really to help too. We'll be doing a work day on Friday, and we decided that the older ones will do the recipes, and the younger ones can do the curbside delivery and, you know, that the preparing on Saturday, etc.
Sure.
So anyway, that's going to happen.
Great. And so for those of you online, she might have been a little bit tough to hear. October 10th, it'll be the meatball drive-through supper this year. And we'll have more information on Facebook for that and on our website. And there'll be some flyers around too as well. And we'll get that out in the newsletter. So there'll be multiple ways you can hear about that prior to the event, and if you're interested in helping out, that would be great. Just give us a call here at the office or talk to your council members. I invite you to stand as you're able as we begin our service with some opening words of faith. Give thanks to the Lord, call on God's name, make known God's deeds among the people, sing praises to God, all of God's wonderful works. Glory in God's holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice.
Seek the
Lord and God's strength. Seek God's presence continually. Remember the wonderful works God has done. And I invite you to be seated. We'll hear our opening hymn this morning.
Doug, about just the closer walk would be in C.
C, okay.
Jesus is my
We confess that sometimes we do not show mercy to those who have wronged us, yet we expect mercy ourselves. Forgive us for our selfish, foolish ways. Forgive us for not seeking your way that turns the world upside down. In your reign, you welcome those who have come around last. You embrace those who realize they need to turn their lives around even at the last moment. You love us all as your children. Help us to love with that same love. Help us to show mercy as you have shown mercy to us. Help us to practice justice that repairs and restores rather than punishes. In the name of Christ, who has shown us the way, the truth, and the life, we pray. Amen. And how great and merciful is our God. How just and true. How wonderful that our God loves and forgives us. How awesome that God accepts us and calls us to love one another as we have first been loved by God. Seek forgiveness from others by doing the hard work toward reparation and reconciliation. And I declare to you that in the name of Jesus Christ, all of your sins are forgiven you today. And God's love and grace are with you always. Amen. And we will be seated as we hear the meditating.
But just as I am without one plea.
E-F-C, I think.
E-C.
C.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. I invite you to share the gift of God's peace with others. In a distance way. Take a moment just to pause now and let the wind slip away. Children today, so I could ask the older children to come up front, but that would not be great. But I will share some of my children's sermon in the sermon today so we can move along. And I look forward to seeing you kids in church soon. I know you've had a lot to do with going back to school and everything else. There's a lot happening in the world right now. So do we have any joys of concern this morning that we would like to add to our prayers? It's all good. How about joys? Birthdays, anniversaries? I know I have a joy. I was able to talk to my son for 3 hours in Germany yesterday, so I'll go add him to my prayers today. Going once, twice, so okay. I'll invite you to stand as you're able, and we'll say our prayers today. The prayers of the people will end with Lord and mercy, and the response will be hear our prayer. Let us pray. Drawn together in the compassion of God, we pray for the church, the world, and all those according to their needs. Generous God, you make the last first and the first last. Where the gospel challenges the church, equipping equip it for its works of service. Strengthen those who suffer for Christ. Where we find envy and create enemies, you provide enough for all. Bring peace to places of conflict and violence. Inspire leaders with creativity and wisdom. Bless the work of negotiators, peacemakers, development workers. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of sun and wind, brushes and bushes and worms, cattle and great cities, nothing in creation is outside your concern. Mighty God, in your mercy, tend to it all. Give us a spirit of generosity toward all you have made. Reveal yourself to all in need as you are gracious and merciful, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love, ready to relent from punishing this world. Accompany judges and lawyers, victims of crime, those serving sentences today. Give fruitful labor and a livelihood to those seeking work. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Even beyond our expectations, you choose to give generously. Grant life, health, and courage to all who are in need. We ask that you continue to bless those who are giving birth during this time, because it is very stressful, Lord. We especially lift up to you today Esther and Rodney Peterson, Isla Calverly, Ozzy Ratzer, Ina Joe, Kurtz Myrie, Clara Lucero, Carol Charlberg, and all those who are preparing for surgery, recovering from illness, struggling with seasonal affect disorder, PTSD, and other conditions. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We praise you for generations that have declared your power to us. Give us faithfulness to follow them, living in Christ, until you call us to join them in the joyful song around his throne. Lord, we just take a moment now to name those silently or aloud who are upon our hearts today. Lift up Oregon, Lord, and all the fires that rage. All these things and whatever else you see that we need, we entrust to your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. And all God's people said, Amen. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, This cup, this is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. And remember us into your kingdom, Lord. And teach us to pray anew. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The body of Christ is given for you. Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace now and forever. Amen. I invite you to be seated as we continue our service with the reading today.
Our psalm today is from Psalm 145, verses 1 through 8, and we will read them responsively. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever.
Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever.
Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable.
One generation
and your works to another shall declare your mighty acts.
On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works I will meditate.
The might of your awesome deeds shall be complained. I will declare your greatness.
They shall celebrate the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness.
The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love.
From Genesis and also from Luke. God promises Abraham descendants as numerous as the stars. Abraham believes. Jesus gives us a stern reminder to bear the fruit of repentance. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, You have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him, This man shall not be your heir. No one but your very own issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, Look toward heaven and count the stars, if you are able to count them. Then he said to him, So shall your descendants be. And he believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. Bear fruits worthy of repentance. Do not begin to say to yourselves, We have Abraham as our ancestor, for I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ. I invite you to be seated. And will you pray with me? Holy Spirit, we just quiet ourselves before you, invite you into our homes, into our hearts, into our midst here in the sanctuary. Open our ears to hear through them, Lord. Open our minds to think through them, and break open our hearts to plant your truths deep within them. Empower us, enlighten us, and strengthen us. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O God. Amen. Well, we moved from creation last week to fast forward 15 chapters ahead, so I feel like I have to catch you up a little bit. We know some of this story already. Adam and Eve had a couple sons. We see the first murder with Cain killing Abel. And Adam and Eve were also cast out of the garden. Then there is a flood. God obliterates all but Noah and his family and the animals in the ark. So kind of like when you think about shaking that
little toy we all used to have where you turn the knob to make the pitcher and then you wipe it out. It's kind of what it feels like. That period of time was like, God just said, we need to start again. And I want you to think about how it's all about relationship as we go through these early chapters of Genesis. God learning his relationship with humanity. And finally, we have people building a tower, Tower of Babel, just prior to Abraham's story beginning in chapter 12. And the people wanted to build a tower in heaven, and as they got it quite high, God said, oh, no, no. It confused them all with language, as the story goes. And so then we come to this man called Abraham, and God asks him to go to pick up everything he wants to have with him and go to a land that he will show him. And so Abraham, at this time named Abram, not Abraham yet, because we know that sometimes God changes names as he fulfills his promises to people. But they're at the beginning of their relationship together, and he says, Abram, go. And so Abram went. And along the way, Abram ran into God again, and he said, I'm going to give you and your wife a child. And they, Abram believed this, and the wife wasn't so sure. They were in their 70s, so kind of imagine if God suddenly told Jody and Dave, gonna have a child in 9 months or soon, might be a little bit laughable, right? Not that you're 75, but just good example. And even for me, I think if God told me you're going to have a child in 9 months, I'd be like, what? This can't be happening. I definitely would laugh and say, you're crazy. But so they've been waiting a while for this to happen, though. We don't really know how long, but I feel like it's been like years. And we pick up this story today in chapter 15 because I wanted to just kind of give you a little context around this. And Abram, thing I love about, I'm going to call him Abraham from now on because Abram is really hard to like get in my mind. But Abraham has a great relationship with God that we see unfold. And God calls Abraham his friend. And I've always loved that. I just think, God, to call me friend, that's a good thing. But Abraham, part of it, I think, is because Abraham has no problem going, you shouldn't do that, God. I don't agree with you. I don't like what you're doing to me. So there's all these conversations. And that's part of a relationship, right? Even if you're so in love and you get married in the first 6 months or a year, you probably can remember times when you had disagreement. And you suddenly thought, who is this person? You know, or in any relationship, there's always a time when you butt heads about something or you don't agree. And so Abraham is kind of pouring out his complaints to God here, and he had said, you know, the first thing we see though is God comes in and says, don't be afraid. And what I notice a lot when God says, don't be afraid, then the person starts to tell God, but this is why I'm afraid, you know. And so he said to him, I'm your shield. And then Abraham said, but what are you going to give me here? I mean, Eliezer is my heir. So he's kind of reminding God, you promised, and we're not seeing anything happening. Sarah still seems to be barren. And God, I think God has a sense of humor sometimes. And he says, come outside. Look at the stars. Count them. So that's where I kind of could picture God with a little bit of a smile.
Taco Stars. And I was gonna ask the kids, you know, could you tell me how many grains of sugar are in this cup? That is kind of like the stars in the sky as you look at that picture of our galaxy in a desert night from NASA. You can see all those little pinny points that are on that screen. It's mind-boggling. And if you've done any camping out at your cabins or lakes or wherever, you know on those starry nights, it's breathtaking. So, of course, Abraham cannot count the stars. God knows that. And he says to him that, this man is not going to be your heir. And if you're able to, you know, when he said, if you're able to count these stars, and then he said, so shall your descendants be as great as the stars. And I think the powerful thing here is Abraham believed the Lord, it says, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. And so that's also a quality of Abraham. Even when he came to him and said, you're going to bear a child, Abraham believed. And then he comes and he said, this is the promise, this is a covenant. Your descendants are going to be more than the stars. Abraham says, okay. I believe you. So I think about what all that means to us, you know, and that's why we've got this little verse from Luke today, remembering that we must always repent of our sinfulness, and we may have Abraham in our DNA, but if we do not believe, God could raise up another Abraham, as he said. And so I think about the place that we're in and the things that we've been through lately, and I think about trust. For me, you know, of course I talked about our sinfulness last week, and of course then I was reminded how much of a sinner that I am. Because this week I had a moment where I had a thought I haven't had in a long time, and I was like, gosh, should I not tell the truth about something? And it was just a fleeting moment, trust me. I didn't fall in there, but I, you know, that thought, I don't know if I should tell the truth about this. And, you know, it was hard realizing that that maybe in my own self-righteousness, even that I would think that I was above wanting to skirt the truth about something. And I think that's what it's like sometimes when we're in stress, you know, share my humanity in that, just, you know, in that moment of going, gee, I don't know, do I do the right thing or do I do the wrong thing, you know? Sometimes it seems simpler to do the wrong thing. And that's why, you know, I encourage you to turn to someone here and say, I need you in my life. Take a minute. Do that. Even if it's your partner. I need you in my life. And we need each other. And that's where we can have somebody kind of just steady us sometimes when we're going through these moments where we're not sure. And for me, I thought, it's a moment of trust. It's a moment of trusting God that you have to come to. And you hear a lot that we're all going through this together right now, right? It's kind of one of those mantras, right? We're all going through this together. And I like that, but I don't like the thought that maybe everybody thinks they're going through the same thing, because we're just not. we may be going through this together, this storm together, but we are in different boats sometimes. It's my boat, not necessarily like your boat. Maybe you're in a battleship and you're going, I'm doing really good in this storm and I am not even feeling the ruck and haven't seen a hit in my 401k or everybody's healthy, got a good job, and then somebody else is over there in a kayak thinking, help me hold on. You know, I don't know if I'm going to make rent next month. And so I encourage you to think about that we are all going through this together, yes, but we're all in very different places. And when you think about the whole, it's thinking about God's promises in light of all that. And one of the things that holds us fast as we're going through those rocky moments sometimes in our lives where we think, oh, I don't know the whole story. You know, I'd like to know what's going to happen. And there's some uncertainty. And I was thinking back, you know, to a year ago with a couple of people that I know that were going through some really tough times, and it was their hope that carried them through. And I reminded some people this week too that, you know, they said, we've never been through this though. And I said, yeah, but you survived a divorce. You survived your car being repossessed. You had an illness that had you in the hospital and you almost died. You survived all of that. And God was present with you. And why wouldn't he be present with you now? So it's remembering. And then also reminding someone that, you know, maybe you don't feel like you've ever been through anything that's rocked your boat before, but remember what was happening to your family around you 10 years ago? People were dying. We were going to a funeral every week. And that was 10 years ago, and you're okay. And I think one of the things that I saw in Abraham this week that relates to us too is that Abraham was kind of thinking about himself as the only one, right? Sometimes we feel like God is an Uber for us. He takes us where we want to go, and we can just give him our laundry list and he's going to, you know, give us what we need right now. And sometimes we have to wait. And also we have to remember that we're not the only one that has ever gone through this. And we are not the only people on earth that have ever gone through a pandemic. And I think that was powerful to think about too. It's not the only pandemic in our history, right? History of the world. So there are throngs of saints in heaven looking down on us saying, you're going to get through this together. Maybe in separate boats, but you're going to make it through. And so with Abraham thinking about his childlessness, God's reminding him, you know, look up. Look up. My promise is in the sky to you. My promise is in the stars. In the bigness of your God is the promise fulfilled. And I thought, that's good advice, right? Because every time I'm looking down at my belly button, kind of, tend to get really narrowly focused and think, nobody else knows what kind of stress I'm going through. But if I look up, I remember that I'm not the only person and that my problems might be finite compared to someone who just lost their job, or had to lay off 150 employees, or found out they had cancer. final little nugget is just remember that God kept God's promises. Continue to hear about the promises of God in the coming weeks, and the promise of a Messiah coming. And God kept God's promise, not only to Abraham, making him the father of a multitude, but also in reuniting his people in a relationship with him. So I think we have to trust a little more. And I feel like it's a pause, right? Pause for Abraham, where God says, go outside. You know, he didn't say, you know what? Quiet, Abraham. He said, no, come with me. Walk with me. Maybe have a little closer walk with me. Outside, think about the bigness of this promise, the bigness of your God. So I think sometimes we stop. We need to stop sometimes and reflect on the goodness of God, the gift of Jesus Christ coming to us as Lord and Savior, forgiving us of all of our sins, reuniting us as the children of God. And that promise we received in our baptism, it's kind of like those little drops of water carry some of that blessing that was the promise that was given to Abraham as we become one with that family. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for your promises. Lord, we know that sometimes we don't trust you enough to keep your promises because it's been a long time coming. But we acknowledge now that you are bigger and you are greater than any problem or pandemic in our lives. And you will keep our ship on top of the waves. Help us to go out now with peace and share the good news of all that you have done for us. Amen. I invite you to stand for the blessing and the closing song. And now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. Lord, make his face shine upon you and look upon you with favor, granting you always his peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Okay, we'll do In the Garden. Everyone move that song if you want to sing along.
Thank you.
God loves you, and so do I.
So come on, I'll fly away.